I have, over the years, trying to preach the gospel, wondered why it is that so many times God's will is not done. Now, we talked about things in class, and we've talked about it many times, about each person having his own will and must be willing to submit to the Lord's will as it's set out in the words of the New Testament. But I think there's even more to this, though I think it is quite simple for us to understand about ourselves, first of all, and about why people would not even obey Christ in his earthly ministry. Paul wrote to the young preacher Timothy in 1 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 3, speaking of himself, who was before a blasphemer and a persecutor and injurious, but I obtained mercy because I did it ignorantly in unbelief. That tells me a lot about Saul of Tarsus, the zealous persecutor of the church of our Lord. He did it ignorantly and in unbelief. It also tells me further what is meant in Romans 10, verse 17, when it says, so then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. You cannot be ignorant of God's truth and have a proper belief in God. He persecuted the church ignorantly and in unbelief. However, when the proper evidence was offered that Jesus Christ of Nazareth is the Son of God, the Savior of the world, the Messiah that he had long looked for, thinking that Christ was a false Messiah, and all those that followed him were blasphemers, then he didn't continue ignorantly and in unbelief. He did not reject the truth. Remember, Jesus said, if you continue in my words, then are you my disciples indeed, and ye shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Jesus also prayed in John 17, 17, Father, sanctify them, which means set them apart, make them holy, dedicate them to doing my will, sanctify them through thy truth, thy word is truth. And we understand then why Paul would tell Timothy, preach the word. It is the seed of the kingdom, Luke 8, 11. When the evidence came to Paul that Jesus Christ was the Son of God, he immediately turned his whole life inside out. What was upside down now was made standing up straight. It took a great deal for him, as it did many people in that day and age, to become Christians, because it wasn't a state of them being in countries that were just free and you understand the truth, you believe it and you obey it and going about your business. There was violent opposition to the church. It also was the case the church didn't back up, that it was truly evangelistic. It saw itself as the army of God. It took the Great Commission very serious of go ye into all the world and preach the gospel, not to most of them, but to every creature, Mark 16, 15. When you read the book of Acts, following the establishment of the church, as Luke records in Acts 2, the brethren went everywhere preaching the word. Even when they were persecuted for it, they just continued to go somewhere else and preach the same thing that got them in the trouble in the first place in this life. You could lose your life in the first century for studying the Bible, as we say today, with somebody. But they did it. That ought to teach us about the kind of faith we need, the kind of faith we must have, and the fervent love that we should cultivate that we might be faithful children of God in all the ways the Bible defines that to be. But in all ages, why, and I raise the question, is God's will not done? Well, I read it really, part of it, in 1 Timothy 1:13. Notice he said he did it ignorantly. That's without knowledge, you know. He did it ignorantly and in unbelief. I would say then the first reason that people do not obey God is because of their ignorance. Have you ever noticed in reading your New Testament how many times Paul himself would write, "I would not have you to be ignorant, brethren"? I quoted a number of those passages many, many years ago and actually had an elder who I think was ignorant get upset because I used the word ignorant so much, and all I was doing was reading what the inspired Word of God said. And I used it properly. I used it like Paul did. So I don't know how he applied it, but it didn't work well for him. But let's face it, you don't know what God's will is unless you know it. And you don't know it unless you study it, or someone teaches you, or both. Another reason is also mentioned by Paul in 1 Timothy 1:13. It's because of unbelief. I don't believe that to be the case. I know what he says. I don't believe it. But there's another one. And some of these, of course, may overlap into each other. But the third one is stubbornness. Just plain old stubbornness. Paul wrote to the Romans in Romans 2:5, "But after thy hardness and impenitent heart, treasurest up unto thyself wrath against the day of wrath and revelation of the righteous judgment of God." I heard of a man who obeyed the gospel many, many years ago, who admitted when he obeyed the gospel that he was convinced of the truth of the gospel some years before he obeyed it. But he was part of a family that was extremely prominent, long time so, in a denominational church, and he just would not admit that what he had seen in the Bible was the truth and condemned the doctrine he followed as the truth. But he said, "I could not resist the truth any longer." And thus he broke down his old stubborn will, which you're the only one that can do that, and I am too, and obeyed the truth he had recognized for a long time. But there's another one. Neglect. The writer of Hebrews was writing to Christians who were actually thinking about leaving the New Testament system of faith because they had been converted from Judaism. They were Jews. And that writer said to them, "How shall we escape if we neglect so great salvation, which at the first began to be spoken by the Lord and was confirmed unto us by them that heard him?" Now that's somewhat frightening, or ought to be, to every one of us who are members of the Church of our Lord. Because you see, these were not people outside of Christ. These were not unbelieving Jews. These were members of the church. And they'd been members for quite some time because they were rebuked by the writer, saying that if you used the time you've been members of the church like you ought to, you would be teachers of others. But you've lost what you had at the beginning. Now you've got to be taught the first principles of the oracles of God again. So how shall we escape if we neglect? It's so easy in our age to neglect important matters. We put them on the back burner, we say, or up on the shelf. And we carry a whole backpack of roundtuits. And every time we think about, we need to do this, we know we must, it's the right thing to do, we reach in that backpack and pull out a roundtuit. We'll get around to it someday. But look how many passages of Scripture we reject when we do that. Such as, "Today is the day of salvation. Now is the accepted time." It's all I have. I've been amazed at brethren everywhere I've been all my preaching life. And a lot of these things back, you know, you learn to accept them after so many years, and they don't jar you like they did at the first time you came to accept them. But how, brethren, can urge people to obey the gospel? You may not have tomorrow. You may not even have this afternoon. And that's true. You may be dead, or I may be, before I finish my next word. But once we get them baptized into Christ, and maybe some of them, as many do, start to drift and hit or missers when it comes to worship and Bible study, then we've got forever to take care of them then. You know, we got them baptized. That's all that was needful. They were baptized to Christ. Their old sins were remitted. We're not too concerned of who's here in this audience then. So we not only neglect our own concern that is not in the likeness of Christ, if we have that view, but we neglect the others who are, by their own will, neglecting themselves. I pose the question of why, going back to the first one of these four, of why are men ignorant? Well, they haven't been taught. Jesus in John 6:45 said, "It is written in the prophets, and they shall be all taught of God." Every man, therefore, that hath heard and hath learned of the Father cometh unto me. Well, that's the sign of being informed by the gospel, isn't it? That's why we're to preach the gospel to every creature. When you think of the Ethiopian convert, Philip being the evangelist, Philip entered the chariot and said, "Do you understand what you're reading?" The answer was, "How can I, except some man should guide me?" And he desired Philip that he would come up and sit with him, Acts 8 and verse 31. And of course, he began at the same scripture where the man was reading after he had made some explanation, that is, the Ethiopian had, and he preached unto him Jesus. There are others who just not only have not been taught, but what they've been taught was a lie, and therefore they're deceived. Thus we all must ever be vigilant and honest with God, ourselves, and the Bible, and learning how to rightly divide the word of truth, that we can be sure that we're right. If you look in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 10 through 12, Paul is talking about how there would be a great falling away from the faith. Well, to fall away from something means you must have it first. So he wrote to the church in Thessalonica and said of this person, or situation actually, "And with all deceivableness of unrighteousness in them that perish." Well, how can that be? Well, he tells us, "Because they received not the love of the truth that they might be saved." Now, if you're honest with God, yourself, in the study of the Bible, and when you read this passage, you automatically must ask, "Do I love the truth? Are there some parts of it that I really just do not hear?" You know, we all like to hear the truth when we're already in harmony with it. But the truth that shows us we're not living up to this, that, or the other, it's not too pleasant to hear. If you look at verse 11, he says, "And for this cause God shall send them strong delusion that they should believe a lie." I think some people read that, in fact, most probably do, and think that, well, here's a person that doesn't love the truth, so God's going to work some kind of a miracle or providentially send something directly. Well, think about it. If you don't love the truth, and it's the truth that sets you free, and God's word is truth, as we noticed a moment ago, if you reject that truth, anywhere you turn from that truth, what do you turn to? You turn to a lie. So when we reject the body of truth concerning salvation, that is the Bible and specifically the New Testament, when we reject any component part of it and you turn to something else, you've turned to a lie. So it's good to be honest of heart with God, with yourself, and dealing with yourself with a lot of what you learn. Notice what's going to happen to people who don't love the truth, that they all might be damned, who believe not the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness. That comes from the same God that loved us and gave his son to die for us and provided us the only way to heaven. But nevertheless, we're talking about People are ignorant because they haven't been taught, and people are ignorant because they didn't love the truth. They believe the lie. They're deceived, and here's how it works. God doesn't want us to be ignorant. In 1 Timothy 2:4, again, think of who that is, a preacher who is to preach the gospel as much as he can to everybody he comes across. Paul wrote to him, who will have all men, speaking of God, who will have all men to be saved and to come unto the knowledge of the truth. No one's going to be saved without knowing the truth. Surely that's been made plain for all who believe the Bible already in this sermon. Then there are those who say, well, if I go there, I'm going to hear things I don't want to hear. They refuse to know. Paul dealt with that when he showed the Gentile non-Jewish race departing from God. You see, everybody once knew and believed in God. Somebody had to leave him. So Romans 1:28, and even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge. Folks, I think that's where we are in the United States of America today. What happens when that takes place? What does God do about people like this? Well, in this life, it says of them, God gave them over to a reprobate mind. You want to know where all this immorality comes from? All the fornication and adultery and homosexuality and all, where does it come from? They do not want to retain God in their knowledge. Thus, they do not want to retain His will in their knowledge. They do not intend to follow the Bible as it is in truth, the Word of God that will judge them on the last day. So God says, well, you have that choice in this life. You're a free moral agent. And thus you're going to leave the truth and you'll have a reprobate mind. And you'll even do those things that aren't convenient. Now, tell you what's going to be formed in a person's mind about right and wrong and morality and so forth when you leave the guidelines of truth? Things couldn't happen as they have in the last... Well, let's just start it with abortion being approved since 1973, but that then snowballs, and you see where we are today in immorality in the nation. That's because people are going more and more against God. They don't retain Him in their knowledge. And they now are becoming very evangelistic and opposing people who preach what I'm preaching right now. And because human churches and some churches of our Lord have wet spaghetti for spines, they will not stand up against it. They some way explain it away so we can be politically correct, not have anybody mad at us. You know the thing in the mind of the modern day religionist and his false view is that the most righteous people in the world don't have anybody mad at them. So you're liable to say anything. Just keep you being angry with me. Because if you are otherwise, then you're judgmental. Of course, as I have all along pointed out, and you realize they are making judgments themselves as they say you're judgmental, but that doesn't seem to bother them. Let me give you a pointer just in passing. Anytime you run across some of these people saying, oh, you're being judgmental, you're judging me, just ask them, why don't you practice what you preach? I don't want to listen to a hypocrite. See where you get. Because they're so blind to what they're doing, they don't know that they're practicing the very thing they're condemning. What they're really saying is, if you will judge everybody like I judge everybody, it's all right to judge. That's really what they're saying. So that's the world we live in. These people I'm mentioning here as to those who are ignorant, they haven't been taught, they're deceived. God doesn't want it that way, but they are, because they're free moral agents and they can choose. So they refuse to know. Do you really expect them to study the Bible in honesty or to study it in any way? God said of His own people in the long ago through the prophet Hosea, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. He could just as well have said, my people are destroyed for their ignorance. Hosea 4:6. Well, leaving that, we pose the question, why do not all believe? Why do not all believe? Well, you know, it's not because there's insufficient evidence. Jesus said of those in His day, believe me that I am in the Father and the Father in me. or else believe me for the very work's sake, John 14:11. That is the miracles he did. John 20:30-31, John was ending that book saying, many other signs truly did Jesus in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book, but these are written that you might believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you might have life through his name. God does not ask us to believe in him or the Christ or the Bible simply because he says it's so. He provides evidence. There are also those who simply will not take time to consider. They're not interested. That was true in the Old Testament. Isaiah wrote, the ox knoweth his owner, and the ass his master's crib. But Israel doth not know, my people doth not consider. Isaiah 1:3. That was the way he began that great book of Isaiah. And that should tell us then that he knew very well the recipients of that book. People are not honest. We need to do a lot of preaching on being honest. Starting right off, what is it to be honest? It's to accept the reality of a matter. Well, when you've got all sorts of philosophies going around saying, you know, what is reality? Is there really a reality? I like the professor who said to the student who wants to know. I mean, if you're just a figment of your own imagination, I don't have time to deal with that. You can eat green apples and go to bed on them, and you'll have lots of figments of all sorts of imaginations. They don't consider. They're not honest. But that on the good ground are they which in an honest and good heart, having heard the word, keep it and bring forth fruit with patience. If you're dealing with somebody trying to teach them the Bible and they show they're not honest time and time again, then you have to get them to realize they must be honest before you can go on and accomplish anything with them. I've already mentioned that people just don't love the truth. 2 Thessalonians 2:10. And thus they're deceived, because when you leave the body of truth pertaining to salvation, you have no other place to go but to a lie. Paul wrote this to the Corinthians in 2 Corinthians 4 and verse 4. In whom the God of this world hath blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. Well, how does that happen? People love this world, and they're not going to think anything about anything else but this world. I try to teach somebody like that the gospel, and they're blinded. He also said to the Corinthians in 2 Corinthians 11:3, but I fear lest by any means, as the serpent beguiled Eve through his subtlety, so your mind should be corrupted from the simplicity that is in Christ. This was written to Christians, folks. We can know the truth from the heart, obey the truth, become Christians, and slip slide away. Evil companionship corrupts good morals. And every way we turn in this nation, there's evil companionship. Then there are those, and they'll always be around, who trust their own feelings. You've got enough of those in the church. Well, it just doesn't feel good. What in the world does that mean? Feels good to me. You remember back when Joseph was sold by his brothers into slavery? They didn't know what they were going to do about telling their daddy about it, Jacob. So they took his coat of many colors and they killed a kid goat, dipped it in the blood, and took it to their daddy and said, my animal has killed him. But it wasn't true, was it? The message was a lie. But the impact of that lie on Jacob, who believed it to be the truth, was exactly the same as it had been the truth. His feelings operated the same way. Jacob believed Joseph was dead because he believed the lie. He went through all those years believing Joseph was dead until the events down in Egypt after Joseph had reached such prominence and power. That can happen to all of us. That's the reason we must be so very sure when it comes to what's right and wrong, how you become a Christian, how you worship God, and all things pertaining to Christianity, that you have the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth on what you believe. Well, leaving that, I want you to think of this question that we introduced earlier. Why are people stubborn? Let me put it this way. Why am I stubborn? Oh, maybe you can ask, is it always wrong to be stubborn? I'm pretty stubborn when it comes to the plan of salvation. I'm pretty stubborn when it comes to the existence of God and the deity of Christ and the inspiration of the Scriptures. Nothing wrong with being stubborn with the truth that you've studied and that you know. But we're talking about people who receive the truth when they already believe something else is the truth when it's not. And it's proved to them that what they believe is wrong, is contrary to the will of God. Why do they remain stubborn? Well, again, we're creatures of choice. And let's face it, a whole lot of us love ourselves quite a bit. Paul warned Timothy of such people as he went about doing his work of preaching the gospel. And it tells a whole lot about why so many people aren't open to the truth today. For men shall be lovers of their own selves, covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, and he goes on down the list. Now, do you think it's important if you're to be a teacher of truth and you love the souls of men that you should know this about people as you go out to meet them? To be forearmed is... Be forewarned is to be forearmed. And that's what Paul was doing. This is the way it's going to be. You're going to sow the seed of the kingdom and you're going to have people like this. Well, of course, we could say they're proud because of pride or they're stubborn because of pride. Here's what we find in Nehemiah 9, verse 29. And testifiedest against them that thou mightest bring them again unto thy law. Yet they dealt proudly and hearkened not unto thy commandments, but sinned against thy judgments, which if a man do, he shall live in them, and withdrew the shoulder and hardened their neck and would not hear. Had a lot of that going on in the Old Testament. Daniel wrote this in Daniel 5:20. But when his heart was lifted up and his mind hardened in pride, he was deposed from his kingly throne and they took his glory from him. That's speaking of Nebuchadnezzar. Here are reasons that people are stubborn. A lot of folks think pretty highly of themselves. And they just don't want to be proven wrong. Then there's a deceitfulness of sin. It always comes back to that. And we're taught as Christians, so we won't fall into this, but exhort one another daily while it is called today. Now listen. Lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. Hebrews 3:13. That means each one of us should be watching out for one another as to what we get ourselves into. When you think about children being reared, especially when homes were as they ought to be, mother was at home all the time with the children, she was constantly watching out for the children. I can remember mother saying, she let me go out and play in the sandbox they'd built for me. And I'd be out there. Maybe I'd been out there 15 minutes or some period of time. And I could hear mother saying, David, where are you? And in my mind, I thought even then, I'm the same place I was and you let me come out here. Well, that's the kind of care we need as brothers and sisters in the family of God to keep one another out of the mess some of us seemingly continually get into. Because sentence against an evil work is not executed speedily. Therefore, the heart of the sons of men is fully set in them to do evil. Ecclesiastes 8:11. Delayed punishment. Oh, this is a biggie when it comes to rearing children. Just threaten them for several weeks and months and never do anything about it. And those threats mean nothing. And we recognize that in the nation. But in the kingdom of God, you don't get too concerned about neglect on the part of your brothers and sisters. But all these serve to make people stubborn. Why do people neglect what they know is good for them? They have other interests. Jesus deals with that in Luke 14, 18 through 20. And those interests simply are more important than the work of the church. Then they tell themselves, as I said in the beginning, there's time enough yet to change, Luke 12, 45. Well, no, believe it or not, someday we'll attend the last worship period such as this, and we'll die before the next one. Now, we know that's coming, but right now you're telling yourself, we'll see you this afternoon, we'll talk about next week. I wonder how many people are doing that. They won't be here this afternoon or next week. And someday, it's my turn. Then people are fearful, just scared of what people don't say about them. Have you ever seen somebody put on the spot and they begin to tell all sorts of stories? Prime example of that's Peter himself, who boasted he would never leave the Lord. Then look at how he denied the Lord three times before the rooster crowed. But oh, he boasted many things. But boy, when you're pushed up against the wall and you know these folks mean business and hurting you, different story. That's what fear will do to you. The one talent man was a man of fear. And I was afraid and went and hid thy talent in the earth. Lo, there thou hast that is thine. Matthew 25:25. That won't work. It didn't work for him, and it's given to show it won't work for us. Waiting for a more convenient time, Acts 24:25, causes us simply to neglect an obligation we know is ours. That's all it does. Paul preaching. And as he reasoned of righteousness, temperance, that's self-control, and judgment to come, the day when all must appear before Christ to give account of the deeds done in the body, Felix trembled. Well, it did impact him, didn't it? But he answered, go thy way for this time. When I have a convenient season, I will call for thee. It never works that way. We have the examples or patterns of others and their conduct. We have the statement in Hebrews 4:11, let us labor therefore to enter into that rest, lest any man fall after the same example of unbelief. There are bad examples in the Bible, called negative examples. Don't do like those people did. And we sing about Nadab and Abihu with the little ones down here all the time. What are the results? Well, it's just, first of all, alienation from God. Having the understanding darkened, being alienated from the life of God through the ignorance that is in them because of the blindness of their heart, Paul wrote to the church in Ephesus, Ephesians 4:18. Take heed, brethren, lest there be in any of you an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God, as we read earlier. The ultimate end of being alienated is destruction, separated from God forevermore in a devil's hell. Now notice this, he that being often reproved hardened his neck shall suddenly be destroyed, and that without remedy. Proverbs 29:1. You know, every one of these things are designed to make us know ourselves as we really are. And we can see ourselves as God sees us, and then in all honesty apply these things to our lives. I want to close with this passage of Scripture, 2 Thessalonians 1:7-9. Very familiar to most Bible students, writing to the church again, reminding them of people that persecuted them, much like the people we've described here, and persecuted them for their faith. And he gives these words of comfort to the faithful. And to you who are troubled, rest with us. When the Lord Jesus shall be revealed from heaven with his mighty angels in flaming fire, taking vengeance on them that know not God and that obey not the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ. What is their condition in eternity? Who shall be punished with everlasting destruction from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of his power? But what about the church, those who die in the faith, when he shall come to be glorified in his saints and to be admired in all them that believe, because our testimony among you was believed in that day? Now, there's not an honest one of us here that does want to be found in that condition if the Lord were to come right now. But here are some of the reasons that God's will is not done. And we need to be honest with God ourselves on the truth that was preached, as well as all truth, and say, is it I, Lord? Do I know things in my life that I ought to be doing? I know it's God's will, but I'm putting it aside. I'm having a good warm feeling that, oh Lord, help me to leave from here and do better. Well, that's for the person who's faithful, wanting to grow in what they're already faithful in. What about the people who say, Lord, I know I'm in transgression of your will, omission or commission? Then the only thing for you to be doing is to take advantage of this invitation and straighten your life up with God by repenting of your sins, confessing your sins, and praying God forgiveness. It's God's second law of pardon for the child of God. But if you've never started down the road of living the Christian life, then you are to receive with meekness the engrafted word which is able to save your soul, which will form faith in you, Romans 10, verse 17. Repenting of your sin, Acts 17, 30. Confessing your faith in the Christ and being buried with him in baptism for the remission of sins. If you need to do that, there is the entrance into Christ to live your life faithful to him and not allow yourself to not do God's will. If you're subject to him, we invite you to come then while we stand and sing.